Spin the wheel, make the deal, climb a pole, and grab a glove as World Championship Wrestling presents Halloween Havoc 1992, taking place on October 25th, 1992, from the Philadelphia Civic Center in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The attendance for this show was 7,000, 5,000 of which paid. The live gate for the show was $75,000, and the pay-per-view buys were $130,000. Lower attendance, higher live gate, and lower pay-per-view buys compared to Havoc 91. And compared to the rest of the WCW pay-per-views in 1992, Halloween Havoc was second highest in attendance, highest in live gate, and second highest in pay-per-view buys. For the context of WCW in 1992, this was pretty good, but overall not so much. Though this would be the highest live gate for a WCW pay-per-view until Spring Stampede 1994, and the most bought WCW pay-per-view until Bash at the Beach 1994, tough times for WCW. Your commentators for the night were Jim Ross and Jesse Ventura, and in the dark match, Van Hammer and Eric Watts defeated the Vegas Connection in 12 minutes. Now time for the From the Vault totals for Halloween Havoc 1992. They are 20 wrestlers, 7 matches, 5 titles on the line in 4 of those matches, we'll explain when I get to the double one, 1 hour, 48 minutes, 40 seconds of total match time, roughly 15 and a half minutes average match time, 2 of these matches going over 20 minutes brings up that average time, 30 minutes for the longest match, 10 minutes, 25 seconds for the shortest match, ring bell error foo, headlock foo, and I don't do star ratings, not anymore at least. This is WCW Halloween Havoc 1992. Like, comment, share, subscribe, click the bell, and enjoy. After the introduction from Tony Schiavone, Bruno Sammartino, Missy Hyatt, Jim Ross, and Jesse Ventura, and them running down stuff on the night, it's on to match number one of Halloween Havoc 1992. It's a 6-man tag team match. Shane Douglas, Tom Zank, and Johnny Gunn versus Arn Anderson, Bobby Eaton, and Michael Hayes. This is a match of the, quote, newcomers and future stars of WCW versus the veterans of the company. Gunn is literally called newcomer Johnny Gunn. Zank has actually been there for a while, so not really a newcomer and not really a future star of the company. Douglas just came back to WCW a little while prior. He got the endorsement from Magnum TA. Meanwhile, the Dangerous Alliance is barely together at this point, though the members still team together, and P.S. Hayes joined as an affiliate and is helping out Arn and Bobby. Very good opening 6-man tag team match here, though the crowd in Philly didn't care about the Douglas Zank Gun trio. Those three were the faces, by the way. Arn, Bobby, and P.S. were the heels, but the heels were getting cheered every chance they got. Even when they were cheating, they were still getting cheered. You can play it off as a smart crowd, but this was still 1992, the era of kayfabe. Faces got cheered, heels got booed. But it was around this time that began the dying days of that era, especially in the city in question. Good back and forth stuff. All six get in the ring at some point. Gunn would hit his Thez Press finisher on P.S. Hayes for the win. The crowd was not happy about that at all, as Shane Douglas, Tom Zank, and Johnny Gunn defeated Arn Anderson, Bobby Eaton, and Michael Hayes in 11 minutes, 2 seconds. Match number 2 was a special challenge match, Ricky Steamboat versus Brian Pillman. After years of being a babyface, Pillman turned heel recently as he was frustrated on not getting a shot at the WCW Light Heavyweight Championship at the most recent Clash due to an injury to Brad Armstrong. Pillman started calling Armstrong a coward despite the fact that Armstrong was injured, and Steamboat wants to teach Pillman a lesson. Originally, this was set to be for the WCW World Television Championship. Steamboat was the champion, though on the October 10th episode of Worldwide, Steamboat would lose the World TV title to Scott Steiner, making this match between Steamboat and Pillman just a normal one-on-one match. And what a hell of a one-on-one match we got between these two. It was great. You can tell Pillman is still learning to work heel here, but he was doing great, and Steamboat, name me one bad match he's ever had. It was even throughout the entirety of the match, trading near falls, simple storytelling throughout the match, but simple sometimes works the most effective. Steamboat eventually gets the pin for the three, as Ricky Steamboat defeats Brian Pillman in 10 minutes, 25 seconds. Now on to match number 3, and it's the first of 4 championship matches on the night. This one being for the WCW United States Heavyweight Championship. The champion is Rick Rude, but in his place as surrogate U.S. Heavyweight Champion is Vader, and he is taking on challenger Nikita Koloff. Rick Rude is in his first reign as United States Heavyweight Champion, defeating Sting at Clash of the Champions 17. So how did we get to this whole situation? Well, Rude and Koloff had been feuding for the bulk of 1992, starting right after Super Brawl 2 and the After Party press conference. Now for Halloween Havoc, it was announced that Rude was going after the NWA World title. But then 8 days out of the pay-per-view, it was revealed that Paulie Dangerously signed an open contract for Halloween Havoc for Rude to defend the U.S. heavyweight title against Nikita Koloff. This was during the story where there was tension between Rude and Paul, but there was no clear direction with that story. It was announced prior to the match by Bill Watts that to avoid an injunction and any sort of legal bullshit, it was agreed that Rude can put someone in as a replacement. After some dealings with Harley Race, Rude chose Vader as his surrogate for the match against Koloff, but it was made perfectly clear by Watts that if Koloff defeated Vader, Rude would lose the U.S. heavyweight title. The match was no disqualification, Medusa was barred from ringside, and then right before the match started, Harley Race and Rick Rude were also barred from ringside. Vader and Koloff put on a damn good hoss fight here, very stiff at points, but what more can you expect? Wish they would have used the no DQ stipulation a bit more. This would be one of Koloff's final matches of his career. They played up the story that Vader injured Koloff here and, quote, ended his career. Truth of the fact is, Vader did injure Koloff, but Koloff would retire under his own terms. He did an interview about it, and he explains the whole situation. Vader hits the powerbomb to end the match, as Vader defeated Nikita Koloff in 11 minutes, 35 seconds, and as a result of that, Rick Rude retains the WCW United States Heavyweight Championship. It's time for match number 4, and this one went under so many damn changes, it's best to start at the beginning. This is the second of 4 championship matches on the night, and this one is for both the WCW and NWA World Tag Team Championships, called during this time the Unified World Tag Team Championships. Initially, this was supposed to be Champions the Miracle Violence Connection versus Challengers the Steiner Brothers. MVC and the Steiners had been feuding since the summer. Doc and Gordy defeated the Steiners in the NWA Tag Tournament. They beat them for the WCW Tag Titles, and ultimately they won the tournament to win the NWA Tag Titles. From that point until fall of 1993, both belts were known as the Unified World Tag Team Championships. But then, on the October 3rd episode of Saturday Night, a new Unified Tag Title match was announced for Halloween Havoc, champions Barry Windham and Dustin Rhodes versus challengers the Steiner Brothers. What happened there? Later on in that same episode of Saturday Night, the Miracle Violence Connection lost the belts to Barry Windham and Dustin Rhodes, so they spoiled what was going to happen in the main event of that show. But during that time, Rick Steiner would suffer an injury, Scott went on a singles run winning the TV title, and a new Unified World Tag Title match was announced for Halloween Havoc, champions Windham and Rhodes versus challengers Doc and Gordy. But then we get to the day of the show, and there's now a new match for the Unified World Tag Team Championships, the reason being, Terry Gordy quit WCW. There's a big disagreement between him and the company. WCW was working with New Japan at the time. Gordy had loyalty to All Japan. So now the match for the Unified World Tag Team Championships, champions Barry Windham and Dustin Rhodes versus challengers Dr. Death Steve Williams and Stunning Steve Austin. They were playing up problems in the Wyndham Rhodes camp in the build of this match. There was dissension in the team, but Wyndham was playing down everything, but this would soon lead to his heel turn. Now, despite the fact that this match was as cold as ice in terms of heat and build because the fans were expecting one thing and what we got was another, this ended up being a really good tag match, and it was the longest match of the night. Great back and forth work here. For Austin and Williams being thrown together and say, hey, you're going to be a team on such short notice, they made a solid team. The big gripe I have here is the final few moments of the match. What was a great match ended on a sour note with some ring bell error. Austin got the pin, seemingly new champions, the bell rings, but it was waved off due to the illegal man. Another pin attempt, we get a two count, the bell rings again. Rhodes hits Austin with a scary-looking tombstone, time reaches zero, flat finish, time limit draw. Typically, draws done right can be exciting, especially the final few moments, but the two bell rings killed any exciting finish as Dustin Rhodes and Barry Windham fight Steve Williams and Steve Austin to a time limit draw in 30 minutes. Wyndham and Rhodes retain the Unified World Tag Team Championships. After the great segment with Paulie and Medusa and the not-so-great segment of the spinning of the wheel, it's on to match number 5, the third of four championship matches on the night, this one for the NWA World Heavyweight Championship. Champion Masahiro Chono versus challenger and United States Heavyweight Champion Rick Rude. Masahiro Chono was in his first reign as NWA World Heavyweight Champion, defeating Rick Rude in the tournament final at G1 Climax Day 5. Due to the match in Japan to determine the brand new champion, each guy can name their own referee for this rematch at Halloween Havoc. Chono names Kensuke Sasaki as his referee, Rude names Harley Race as his referee, but a coin toss was done to determine the inside referee, which Harley Race won. There were loud, "We want Flair" chants with this one, and this one, yeah, this match sucked. And it's not the fault of either Rude or Chono, it's the fault of the people that decided this match should have even taken place. For some context, about a month prior to this pay-per-view, Chono defended the NWA World title against Steve Austin. During that match, Austin performed a sit-down tombstone out of Chono, and Chono suffered a very bad neck injury. Quite frankly, this match should have never taken place to begin with, but it did. You get many rest spots, a whole lot of nothing, the crowd chants boring. You think that with the injury, you cut the match in half, if not more, to get it done and over with, but somebody decided, let's put the guy with the injured neck in a 20-minute match. This is one of the worst matches I've ever seen from either of the two participants. Chono throws Rude over the top rope. Race calls for the disqualification because of the NWA over-the-top rope rule. Rick Rude defeated Masahiro Chono by disqualification in 22 minutes, 23 seconds. Masahiro Chono retains the NWA World Heavyweight Championship. Match number 6 is the penultimate match of the night, and it's the fourth and final championship match of the pay-per-view. This one is for the WCW World Heavyweight Championship. Champion Ron Simmons versus Challenger the Barbarian. Ron Simmons was in his first reign as WCW World Heavyweight Champion, defeating Vader on the August 2nd, 1992 episode of Main Event. Simmons had been feuding with Cactus Jack since winning the world title, even defeating him at Clash of the Champions 20 in September. Cactus is forming a group of wrestlers to take down Ron and get the world title. They would elevate Barbarian from tag team wrestler to main eventer in no time at all. In the build-up to the pay-per-view, they showed Barbarian's toughness in various different vignette segments. Now, I'm not gonna say Simmons versus Barbarian was a bad match. At best, it was an alright power match. But A, we saw a better one earlier on in the show in Koloff versus Vader. And B, nothing against Barbarian, he was a good big man, a good tag team wrestler. However, Barbarian was not a main eventer. There wasn't any chance anyone believed he was winning the world title on this show. This pairing looks like we need a body to lose to Ron, so why not put Barbarian in there? It won't hurt him, so let's just do this. It was okay, but it was predictable as hell. Power slam, 3 count, and it's over, as Ron Simmons defeated the Barbarian in 12 minutes, 41 seconds to retain the WCW World Heavyweight Championship. And with 6 matches down and 1 more match to go, it's time for the main event of Halloween Havoc 1992, the unsanctioned lights-out match determined by the spin of the wheel, spin the wheel, make the deal, Sting versus Jake Roberts. Jake debuted in WCW back in August to eliminate Sting from the company. After some time of feuding, a pay-per-view match was scheduled. The concept of spin the wheel, make the deal was a Dusty Rhodes creation, similar to the creation of War Games. Spin the wheel, make the deal was a concept from Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome called Bust a Deal, Face the Wheel. Here, it would be a giant wheel with different match types, 12 in total. The spin of the wheel determines the stipulation of the match. The what the hell is a Prince of Darkness match. In the build-up towards the pay-per-view to help build the matchup, you had the legendary infamous Spin the Wheel, Make the Deal mini-movie. Then we get to the show earlier on in the night, Sting would spin the wheel. Both guys were told that this was a shoot, though Jake hypothesizes that this was a sabotage job, because when Sting spin the wheel, it landed on Coal Miner's glove. A loaded glove on a pole, first to get it can use it, match ends by pinfall or submission. Seriously, what the fuck was this? Had this been any other stipulation match, this could have been great, because on paper, Sting versus Jake Roberts sounds like a great matchup. But given the stipulation of Coal Miner's glove, they tried their hardest. You could tell Sting was giving it his all. But Jake? Jake had 1 foot in the door, 1 foot out the door. I tend to believe Jake when Jake says that this was a sabotage, because Jake didn't like Bill. Bill didn't like Jake. Jake went from a big money contract to when Bill took over. Bill ripped up the contract and Jake was making a fraction due to their heat. And it was not long that Jake would be out of WCW. He would only make a few more appearances after this, but yeah, Jake did not give a shit at this point. Sting did an awesome swing around the pole, and the hell's about the best thing I can say here. Sting got the loaded glove, Jake had the snake, Sting hit Jake from behind with the glove, Jake puts the snake to his face, and it bit him. He had to keep it at his face for the remainder of this entire thing, which wasn't much longer, because 1, 2, 3, it's over. Sting defeated Jake Roberts in 10 minutes, 34 seconds. And that was Halloween Havoc 1992. The show started off really good and had the makings of a great overall show, but from the finish to the World Tag Title match, to the boring NWA title match, to the okay, nothing special WCW title match, and concluding with Coal Miner's glove, those things drag this show down. By no means is this a completely awful show, but it's not that great of a show either. At best, I would say that this pay-per-view is a very middle-of-the-road show, a tale of two halves to say the very least. But now on to the Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell for WCW Halloween Havoc 1992. I give the Golden Ring Bell for best match to Ricky Steamboat versus Brian Pillman. Had the World Tag Title match had a more exciting finish, that would have gotten this spot, but the miscues at the end put that one behind this one, and this one here with Steamboat and Pillman was damn good. And I give the Brown Ring Bell for worst match to Rick Rude versus Masahiro Chono. It's a match that shouldn't have even happened to begin with, but since it did, it shouldn't have been 22 minutes. Cut it to 10, and it would have been less shitty, and it would have put the main event in this spot. But as always, this is just one man's opinion. What about you? Share your thoughts on Halloween Havoc 1992 in the comments section below. Ask questions about the show, and I'll answer them. Favorite and least favorite match on the night, and the question of the week, What do you think is a Prince of Darkness match? Wrong answers only. Until next time, peace.
It's the interview queen, Alicia Tu, and I would like to introduce you all to From the Vault, a weekly wrestling discussion hosted by James over on We Are Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episode you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter, be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye!